Tonight's introduction was supposed to be given by Matt Parker. He's a wonderful comedian, mathematician, and friend. However, he had a last-minute conflict, so instead of giving his introduction live, he's going to give his introduction by video. And so I give you Matt Parker. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cindy. It is now my absolute pleasure to give the introduction for tonight's math encounter. I always enjoy coming to MoMath, all the fantastic exhibits all around here. Of course, I'm filming this in the place where you're watching it for a bit of an extra hilarious math recursion. So I was in doing a talk last night. If you were there for that as well, you're in for an absolute treat this evening. If not, you're still in for an absolutely brilliant night. My name is Matt Parker. I write about mathematics. I used to be a high school math teacher, and I'm based in the UK, but I'm probably most familiar from doing things in this video format. In fact, those of you who didn't come last night made the right choice. I am terrifying in high resolution, confined to a pixelated screen is vastly superior, and it was a real shame I wasn't able to make it along this evening, but I'm here to introduce your speaker, Jen Rogers. And you may know Jen from messing around in the background of my video. Jen is gonna go and get ready for her talk, which is in 24 hours from our point of view. That's fine, she'll get changed. So anyway, what can I say about Jen? My goodness, she is a woman of statistics. She is a lecturer in statistics at the University of Oxford. She's also the director of their stats consultancy unit. If you want to consult on some stats, she is the person to talk to. She's also the vice president of the Royal Statistical Society. She is the president of the British Science Association. Well, she is for 1 year, it's a very temporary position. And possibly most importantly, her number one credential is she appears in some of my YouTube videos. If you've watched my YouTube videos, don't watch them now during Jen's talk, but later on, if you haven't seen them, you can look them up. She talks about stats, and it's absolutely fantastic about it. So it's my real pleasure to welcome to the stage Jen Rogers.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to MoMath for the invitation and Math Encounter, for having me here. So Matt and I were actually over from the UK, where we're both speakers in something called Maths Inspiration, where we perform in big theatres all around the UK. We put on these big productions for teenagers to try and inspire them about maths. And MoMath very kindly invited us out to give one of our Maths Inspiration shows out here. So that's what we were doing yesterday. And then Matt gave a presentation last night, and you have my company this evening. As Matt said, I am a lecturer and researcher based at the University of Oxford. Has any of you been to Oxford before? Okay, a couple of you. A lot of people think that Oxford is kind of like a set of Harry Potter, and it is. It's a very, very beautiful place to work. I'm very, very lucky to be able to call this my workplace. I actually live about 10 miles out of Oxford as well, a little place called Whitney, which is just on the edge of the Cotswolds. So I am very lucky to come from a very, very beautiful part of the world. As Matt said, I am a lecturer at the University of Oxford, and I am the director of the Statistical Consultancy Unit. I'm not actually president of the British Science Association. I'm president of their maths section. And yeah, vice president for the Royal Statistical Society. Matt actually came along to the Royal Statistical Society conference at the beginning of September, and we filmed a YouTube video together where we did a capture-recapture to try and estimate the number of people who had actually attended the conference. And I think that's going to be coming out in the next couple of weeks. So yeah, do keep an eye out for that. It was a lot of fun, to do. So what am I going to be talking to you about today? So the title of my talk is Calculated Risk. So I do an awful lot of work with various media outlets talking about risk and probability. An example of some of the work that I did was for this picture here is me on a program called Mystery Map, where they were debunking different mysteries. And I was asked to work out the probability of dying from spontaneous human combustion. Now, for all of you skeptics out there, it does actually get recorded as a cause of death. The last reported case of spontaneous human combustion was in Galway in Ireland in 2010. This guy's coroner's report actually has on it, as his cause of death, spontaneous human combustion. And I was asked to work out the probability of this happening. You can kind of work out the probability of your cause of death being spontaneous human combustion. And the way I did that was to look at how many cases there'd been. It was about 200 since 1650. How many deaths there'd been since 1650. And from that, I calculated your probability of your cause of death being spontaneous human combustion as about 1 in 70 million. So a very, very small probability. I also talked about other ways that you might die. It was a really, really upbeat program. So there's an example of some of the weird probabilities that I get asked to calculate. And as I said, I do an awful lot of work talking about risk and communicating risk and the kind of risks that we see in the media all the time. So what kind of risks am I talking about? We say that night owls risk early death. Excess drinking can take years off your life. Just one concussion can increase your risk of Parkinson's disease. And even sitting too long can increase your risk of dementia. We could put some numbers on some of these. So we have the HRT nearly doubles the risk of ovarian cancer. Painkillers can double the risk of heart attacks and strokes. And a child's risk of brain cancer triples after just 2 CT scans. Now, these are all really shocking statistics. And we're expected to use these headlines to inform our day-to-day lives. So what I thought I would do in this talk is give you a kind of toolbox as to the sorts of questions you should be asking yourself when you see headlines like this. What are the things that you should be asking? I thought I'd start out, though, by just finding out how good you guys are at knowing what risky activities are. Let's figure out what I'm working with here tonight. So what I've done, I'm going to do a survey. I'm a statistician, of course. I'm going to do a survey. I'm going to give you a couple of options. I'm going to ask you which you think is the more risky activity. So the first one I'm going to ask you is, which animal causes more deaths annually worldwide? Is it crocodiles or hippos? So give me a cheer if you think it's crocodiles. Yeah, there's a couple of you. Give me a cheer if you think it's a hippo. That's overwhelmingly in favor of the hippo, but I can tell you actually that crocodiles cause a lot more deaths than hippos do. So it's 500 deaths a year for hippos, 1,000 deaths a year for crocodiles. So it's not looking good, is it? Which is the more dangerous mode of transport? So which one, as you're doing it, are you more likely to die from? Is it riding a bike or driving a car? Give me a cheer if you think it's riding a bike. And give me a cheer if you think it's driving a car. That's a little bit more even, but I think you're still in favor of the car over the bike. I can tell you, for every billion hours that you do each of these activities, there are 130 deaths if you are driving a car, and there are 550 deaths if you are riding a bike. So actually, riding a bike is more dangerous than driving a car. Okay, the last one. We're going to American sports here. So which sport causes the most injuries per the number of people that take part in them? So is it baseball or is it cheerleading? Give me a cheer if you think it's baseball. And give me a cheer if you think it's cheerleading. Okay, you guys know your American sports. I can tell you that for every 100,000 people that take part in each of these, you've got 20 injuries for cheerleading and you've got 16 injuries for baseball. So, yeah, you redeemed yourself when it came to American sports. And I want to talk, first of all, about something that comes up in the UK press all the time. It's one of these things that you should never eat. You know, it comes up all the time. It causes cancer. It causes heart disease. It's really bad for you. And it's bacon. So in the UK, we like our bacon sandwiches. We like our fry-ups. I know you guys like to put them on pancakes. Bacon, it's a good staple food. However, apparently, it's not very good for you. You got a higher cancer risk. Eating 2 rashers of bacon a day increases your risk of stomach cancer. A daily fry-up boosts cancer risk by 20%. Now, when this statistic actually came out, when these headlines came out, bacon sales plummeted, and people stopped buying bacon. You know, increasing your risk of pancreatic cancer by 20% if you eat bacon sounds like a really shocking statistic. Now, I was asked to investigate this a little bit further. Now, the crucial thing about this statistic is that it's what's called a relative risk. It only tells us the risk in one group relative to another. Doesn't actually tell us anything about what the risk is. All I know is that it's higher by 20% in one group compared to the other. So I thought, okay, let's delve a little bit and have a look at the actual numbers associated with this. So I had a look on Cancer Research UK. It says that your risk of pancreatic cancer is a 1 in 80 lifetime risk. Okay, what does that mean? That means if we were to take 400 individuals who didn't eat bacon, we would expect 5 of them to get pancreatic cancer anyway. So let's look back at that headline again. Our daily fry-up boosts our cancer risk by 20%, or a fifth. And what's a fifth of 5? It's just 1. Meaning that if we eat bacon every single day, our risk goes from 5 in every 400 people to 6 in every 400 people. It's only an extra 1 person in every 400. But that would have been a very different headline to boost cancer risk by 20%. There were also headlines that said that bacon, ham, and sausages were now as big a cancer threat as smoking, the World Health Organization were to warn. Now, the reason is the World Health Organization produces these lists every year of things that are definitely known to cause cancer, the known risk factors. And processed meat had been added to this list for the first time, and smoking was already on there as a known risk factor for lung cancer. And they were saying that because they were now both on this list, they were as big a cancer threat as each other. But these lists are only based on something called statistical significance. I'm going to talk about statistical significance in more detail later on in my talk. But briefly, what this does is it just says whether or not something definitely does or doesn't cause cancer. It doesn't quantify the risk in any way. It's just a yes, no, does it or doesn't it? So how do the stats for smoking and lung cancer compare to the stats for bacon and pancreatic cancer? Here, let's take our 400 individuals again. If you don't smoke, we would expect 4 of them to get lung cancer anyway. If you smoke 25 or more cigarettes every single day, that risk actually goes up 24 times to 96 in every 400. So it's an extra 92 individuals in every 400 compared to that 1 in 400 for the bacon and pancreatic cancer. So yes, they may both be statistically significant in increasing your risk of cancer, but to say that they are as big a cancer threat as each other is probably pushing it a little bit too far. Now, you'd think that these newspapers would learn their lesson. So when Matt was giving his talk, after his talk and he was having some conversations to people, I was, you know, flicking through my phone, had a look on BBC News, let's catch up with what's going on at home. And this was the headline that I saw. Processed meat linked to breast cancer. So apparently bacon now causes breast cancer as well. So there's a newspaper article yesterday saying that eating bacon increased your risk of breast cancer by 9%. And so I had a look at the stats on that. If you don't eat bacon, we've got our 400 individuals again, you'd expect 57 of them to get breast cancer. So women, you'd expect 57 of them to get breast cancer anyway. 9% increase of that takes it to 62. So it's only an extra 5 in every 400. But again, they keep running these headlines that make it seem like these risks are a lot worse than what they are. And what they also do is they tend to use the extremes as then an excuse for you to never, ever do that activity. So if you eat bacon every single day compared to never eating it, that increases your risk of pancreatic cancer by 1 in every 400 people. But if you only eat it, say, once a week on a Saturday morning as a treat, that's going to have an even smaller effect. And yet they use these headlines as reasons for you to never, ever do these risky activities. What you've also got to think about is that if you're eating bacon for breakfast every day, you're not eating fruit for breakfast every day. You may also have a more unhealthy lifestyle in general. So how do we know that it's the bacon that's actually causing this increased risk of cancer, and that it isn't one of these other lifestyle factors instead? And what we say in statistics is that correlation doesn't always mean causation. One of my favorite examples of this are these headlines here. So one can of fizzy drink a day will make teenagers behave more aggressively. Fizzy drinks make teenagers violent. Children drinking fizzy drinks are regularly more likely to carry a gun. Now, it could be that drinking fizzy drinks makes teenagers go a bit crazy. Or it could be that there are some other social demographic factors which mean you are more likely to drink fizzy drinks, and also you are more likely to be violent. Or It could be that being violent is thirsty work, and at the end of it, you want a fizzy drink. You know, we don't know which way round that relationship goes. You know, think about correlation causation. One of the best ways to explain this is if you think about ice cream sales. As ice cream sales go up, so do the number of drownings. So does that mean that eating ice cream causes people to drown? No. Both of these things are affected by something. The temperature. As the weather gets better and the temperatures increase, we are more likely to eat ice cream and we are more likely to go into the ocean, meaning that there are naturally just more drownings. And once we account for this in our analysis, that relationship, that direct relationship between ice cream and drownings disappears. We call this hot weather a confounder. And when we carry out our analyses in observational studies, we have to allow for these confounding effects to make sure that we're not going to get these, you know, causal relationships that aren't there. There's a really nice website that you can actually go on. If you Google spurious correlations, it's the first website that comes up, and you can look at all these weird and wonderful things that seem to be correlated with each other. Like, a number of Nicolas Cage movies is correlated with weird and wonderful things. I've picked out some of my favorites. So, there is a 95% correlation between the per capita consumption of corn syrup and the divorce rate in Florida. So does that mean that if you want to avoid divorce, you shouldn't eat sugar? I don't know. There's a 99% correlation between the revenue generated by arcades and computer science doctorates awarded. So does that mean that computer science doctorates are spending a lot of time playing arcades? I mean, maybe. I mean, that one's probably maybe. But my absolute favorite is that there is a 95% correlation between the per capita consumption of cheese and your chances of dying by becoming tangled in your bedsheets. So does this mean that we shouldn't eat cheese before we go to bed because we might die? You know, no, of course not. These are two things that just happen to be correlated with each other, and it doesn't mean that one is causing the other. Now, you might be thinking to yourself, okay, these are all really nice examples. They're all very funny, but we obviously know that eating cheese isn't going to cause death by bedsheets. You know, when do I actually really need to think about this? Well, there was a study in the BBC that I was asked to comment on at the beginning of last year, which said that living near a busy road increased your risk of dementia by 7%. Now, I actually went and then had a look at this study. It was published in The Lancet. And if you had a look and you looked for all of the things that they controlled for, they didn't actually control for family history in the study. Now, I argued that, well, family history is a well-known risk factor for dementia. And it could be argued that family history also affects where you're likely to live. If you grow up in the countryside, you may be more likely to carry on living in the countryside as an adult. If you grow up in the middle of a big city, you may be more likely to carry on living in a big city as an adult, meaning that you've got this family history element to where you live, and also this family history element as to whether or not you may or may not get dementia. And the fact that they ignored this from their study, I thought, was a major flaw. If you also look at the supplementary material of this study, you can see some other risk factors. So if we look at this top row here, oh, that disappeared. So this dementia row here, we can see that if you smoke, that increases your risk of dementia by 30%. That's what that 1.3 means. It means you increase your risk of dementia by 30%. If you are obese, you increase your risk of dementia by 64%. If you have a low versus high education, you increase your risk of dementia by 59%. And yet it was this living near a busy road increasing your risk of dementia by 7% that all the newspapers chose to report. And my argument was that before you know picked up sticks and moved to the countryside, there were other things that you could be doing, other lifestyle choices that you could be making that could have a much bigger effect on your risk of getting dementia. So these are things that you need to think about when you're doing observational studies. I do an awful lot of work in medical research. That would be my main area of expertise. And in particular, I do an awful lot of research in clinical trials. Now, in clinical trials, what we would typically be doing is looking at a new treatment. So testing a new treatment. I work mainly in heart failure. And we would be looking to see whether or not, you know, it improved the number of times you had to go to hospital or the number of heart attacks you had, things like that. And clinical trials are run very, very differently to observational studies. I often get asked, why do we test these treatments? You know, why do we go through these formal clinical trial processes that take up so much time and cost so much money? And I always say that new doesn't always mean better. And in actual fact, for every 100,000 chemicals that are ever researched, only 4 make it to be licensed for prescription. Now, I want to talk about the Ebola virus. Now, the last epidemic of the Ebola virus, the big one that was a few years ago now, this was when people changed the way they thought about treating Ebola, and they were trying to develop lots of drugs, lots of vaccines to prevent people getting it, but also vaccines to help you if you got it. And I want to talk about some of the stats associated with this as a justification as to why testing of treatments is really needed. So these stats are a little bit old now, but they're not too far away from what the final numbers ended up as. So there were over 28,500 reported cases of Ebola and over 11,000 deaths. Now, when this epidemic first started, everybody just went into panic and was trying to do anything that they could to get a handle on this virus, spreading, because it was just spreading uncontrollably. And one of the treatments that was currently being developed but hadn't actually made it through to the licensing stage was a drug called ZMapp. And they started giving ZMapp to individuals just to see if it would help. And they gave it to 3 people to start off with. The first 2 were from the US, and William Pooley was from Britain. And they gave ZMapp to these 3 individuals, and they recovered. And everyone thought, great, brilliant. We're actually going to be able to control this. Everything's going to be okay. So they carried on giving it to people, and they gave it to 2 more. Now, unfortunately for these 2 individuals, this treatment didn't work. Now, if we look back at the numbers that I presented before, that 11,000 deaths from 28,500 cases, we can see that 40% of the people who got Ebola died from it, meaning that 60% of people recovered from it naturally. And if we look back at these 5 individuals, we can see that 3 of them recovered and 2 of them died, which is 60% recovering and 40% dying. So how do we know that it was the ZMapp that actually made these individuals recover from Ebola? And they weren't actually just in that 60% of people who would have recovered anyway. And this is why clinical trials are so important. So what do we do when we run a clinical trial? We take a number of individuals, we take a sample, and we split them into 2 groups. We have a treatment group, and we have a placebo group. Now, our placebo group could sometimes be a genuine placebo, where we don't give them anything. Or it usually is standard practice. So if I'm doing a trial for heart failure, it would be unethical for me to take someone's standard medication away from them and put them on a true placebo. So what I would actually be comparing is some new intervention with what the current standard practice is. And what we would do is we would then follow these 2 groups up through time, and at some point we would take a look and we would see how many people recovered in each group. And what we're crucially interested in isn't just do people in the treatment group recover, but do more people in the treatment group recover compared to the placebo group. As I said, clinical trials, they're controlled a little bit more than observational studies. First thing that we do is we carry out something called randomization. And what that does is it decides which group every patient ends up in. And it could be something as simple as flipping a coin. You know, heads in one group, tails in the other. Why do we do this? So what randomization does is it ensures that the 2 groups are as similar as possible in every single way apart from the treatment that they get. So it makes sure we've got the same amount of males and females in each group, the same sort of age distributions in each group, the same sort of medical histories in each group. So the only difference between those 2 groups is the treatment, meaning that if we see a difference in their recovery, it has to be because of the treatment and not because of something else, not because, you know, all the women were in one group and the men were in the other. We also don't tell people what they're taking. We have blinding. And the reason for that is that it prevents something called the placebo effect. Now, has anybody heard of the placebo effect? Yeah, quite a few people. My favorite example of the placebo effect was a study that was done in 1996, where they looked at a new local anesthetic called trevaricaine. And it was just this brown liquid that you could just paint on a bit of your skin and it would numb it. So what they did was they took a group of students and they took their fingers and they put trevaricaine on one of the fingers and left the other one untreated. Then they put their fingers in a vise and then they turned the vise and they asked them if it hurt. And everybody said that the one that didn't have this local anesthetic on it hurt a lot more. Trevaricaine is made of water, iodine, and thyme oil. It's basically water. It does nothing. The iodine was in there to turn it brown so that it looked like a medicine. And the thyme oil was in there to make it smell medicinal. And then they had people, you know, in white coats and putting on gloves to administer it, and it all looked the part. But it was just this placebo effect. Because these people thought they were getting something that was going to make them feel better, they automatically just assumed that that was it, that they felt better. So blinding prevents this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a hypothetical clinical trial. So let's just say we've got this new treatment, paracetamol, and we want to see if it helps people recover from headaches. And we're going to compare this to a placebo group. Let's say we've got 100 people in each group, and we see 65% of people recovering in our paracetamol group compared to 60% recovering in our placebo group. Now, as a medical statistician working in clinical trials, this is the kind of data that I see on a day-to-day basis. And it would then be up to me to decide whether or not there was enough evidence here to say that our paracetamol group was doing better than our placebo group. And there are a number of things that we need to think about when we see data like this. And the first thing is something called uncertainty. Now, down this row, there should have been coins sitting on each of your chairs. So could you get those coins for me now? So you've got some nice British two-pence pieces. And what I'm going to ask you to do is I'm just going to ask you to flip your coins 10 times. I'm going to keep a count of how many times you're doing it, and I'm just going to ask you to count how many heads you get. If you don't feel confident flipping the coin, just give them a shake in your hand and put them on the floor. I don't care how you do it, but just count how many heads you get, and I'll count how many times you're doing it. Okay? So, one. Two. Three. This is a great thing to do with teenagers on stage. Four. Five. Six. Seven, eight, nine, and 10. So hands up if you were with a coin, so I know who I'm asking. How many heads did you get? Seven, four, eight, five, four, three, six. Five.
Two.
Two.
Four.
Four. So we can see everybody there had a fair coin with a 50-50 chance of a head and a tail. So if you were to flip that coin 10 times, you would expect to get five heads and five tails. But that wasn't actually what we saw. I think it was the smallest two and the highest seven or eight, something like that. This is uncertainty. So in statistics, we talk about the difference between probability theory and statistical inference. Now, in probability theory, we know what the underlying probability is. But when we run experiments, we see noisy data. So I know that when I flip a coin, I've got a 50-50 chance of getting a head or a tail. But when I actually run experiments with that coin, I don't always see five heads and five tails. Sometimes I see two heads. Sometimes I see five heads. Sometimes I see six, seven. You know, we see this noisy data. In statistical inference, what we're trying to do is we're trying to go the other way. So we're taking samples of data that we know are noisy and subject to uncertainty, and we're trying to use that data to tell us something about the underlying probabilities. So when I look at my clinical trial, I'm not interested in whether or not 60 is different from 65, because it obviously is. But those 200 people are just a sample. And it's a realization that's noisy data that I know is subject to uncertainty. I'm trying to use that to tell me something about my underlying chances of recovery from a headache in the two treatment groups. If I took a different 200 people, I wouldn't see exactly 60 and 65% recovering. I'd see something slightly different. A different 200 people would give me something slightly different again. So when I'm doing my analysis, I have to take this uncertainty into account, and I have to think about what is that sample saying about the underlying probabilities. Now, there is something that I can do to try and help myself in this situation. Now, there are some of you who have got dice. This is not the time to use them. Hold fire. That time will come. I can tell you all getting very excited. This is something else. So I've run some computer simulations off some dice. And if you've got a fair dice, you've got a 1 in 6 chance of getting a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, meaning that if I was to roll that dice lots of times, I would expect to see about the same numbers of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. If I saw lots of one number or too few of another, then I might have reason to believe that I've got a biased dice. So I've run some computer simulations of dice, and I am going to show you what they look like after a certain number of rolls, and I'm going to ask you if you think it's a fair dice or a biased dice. It will become very obvious once I start. So here's the first one. Here's what it looks like after 10 rolls, 20, 50, and 100. So what I'm going to get you to do is I want you to all stand up for me. Everybody could just stand up. If you think that this is a fair dice, I would like you to sit back down. If you think it's a biased dice, I would like you to stay standing. So sit down for fair, say standing for biased. Okay, I think you might be about 50-50. So anybody who thinks it's a biased dice, you want to just shout out the number that you think is biased?
Three.
Three, you think it's three. Okay, you can sit back down. Thank you very much. I could tell you that this one is a biased dice, but not in the way that you think. It's not that three that's biased. It's this number six here that actually has a higher probability than all of the others. And if actually I take that up to 1,000 rolls, we can now see that this number six is about twice as high as all the others that have started to level off. Okay, we've got two more. I won't get you to stand up this time. We'll just do hands. So up for biased, down for fair. So this is what it looks like after 10, 20, 50, and 100. So what do you think? Hands up for biased, hands down for fair. Okay, we've got a few hands starting to go up. It's the power of the crowd, isn't it? But I think most of you think that it's a fair dice. I can tell you that that one is a fair dice. So well done. If we take that up to 1,000 rolls, we can see that they've all leveled off, and we can see that a lot more clearly. Okay, so last one. Here's what it looks like after 10, 20, 50, and 100. What do you think? Fair or biased? Hands up for biased, hands down for fair. All right, I think that's a pretty unanimous for bias. Do you want to shout out what number you think is biased? It is, obviously, yeah, of course. Obviously, it is a biased dice, and it is biased in favor of number six. But also, it's biased in favor of one and three. And this last example is a really nice example of the interplay between treatment effect sizes and sample sizes. If I have a new treatment that is only slightly better than what I have currently, I'm only going to have a very small treatment effect. There's only going to be a very small difference between the two. And in general, the smaller the sample size, the more uncertainty you have on your data, the more noisy it is. So if you think you've got a treatment effect that's only very small, you've got two probabilities, underlying probabilities that are very close to each other. As you take samples and have actual noisy data, they're going to be bouncing around quite a lot. And you're not actually going to be able to see that there's very much difference between the two. So what you need to do is you need to increase your sample size to decrease the uncertainty so that you can then actually see that there's a difference between the two. If, on the other hand, you have a very big difference between your two underlying probabilities and your treatment effect size is really big, well, even if I've got a small sample size and there's a lot of uncertainty on that, kind of doesn't matter because I can still see that there's a difference between the two. They're sufficiently far away from each other that I can see that there's something going on. And that's what happens in clinical trials. So if we've got something that's only slightly better than what we currently have, we need these massive clinical trials with loads and loads of people to be able to see that there's anything going on. You can see in this example, 4 and 11 is very different to all the others. Okay, so 20 rolls, you can't really see there's anything going on. By the time we get to 50 rolls, we can already see that there's something going on with that number 6. But the 1 and the 3, it's only actually when we take it up to 1,000 rolls, when we increase that sample size, that we can actually then see what's going on. And they're closer to what the true underlying probabilities are. So I have to think about all these things when I'm running my clinical trial. So this is our clinical trial that we had. We got our 65 and 60 with 100 people in each group. Now, there is a formal test that I can carry out that takes into account all of this uncertainty and the sample sizes and things like that. And it's called a hypothesis test. Has anybody heard of hypothesis testing? Okay, quite some of you. For those of you who haven't, in hypothesis testing, we assume there are two hypotheses, the null and the alternative. So the null hypothesis says that actually the underlying probabilities in each group are exactly the same. They're exactly the same, these two groups. And our alternative hypothesis then says that there is a difference between the two groups. And what we do in our hypothesis testing is we assume that the null hypothesis is true. So we assume that there is actually no difference whatsoever between these two treatment groups. They're exactly the same. Your underlying chances of recovery in the two are exactly the same. What my hypothesis test then says is, okay, if that's true, what is the probability of me seeing the data that I've got? So what is the probability of me seeing 65 and 60% recovering if actually the two are exactly the same? And I call that a p-value. If my p-value is pretty big, then that means I've got a high probability of seeing this even if the two are exactly the same. I don't really have any evidence to say that there's a difference between the two. If, on the other hand, that p-value is very small, I'm saying my chances of seeing this if the two are exactly the same is only really small. So maybe they're not the same, and maybe my paracetamol is doing better than my placebo. So what is my p-value for this data here? My p-value for this is 0.47, so 47%, which is pretty high. We have a 47% chance of seeing this, even if the two are exactly the same. I don't really have enough evidence there to be saying that paracetamol is doing any better than the placebo group. But what if I took this up to 1,000 people? Well, now I've got a little bit more confidence in those numbers that I see, a little bit more confidence that they're closer to what the true underlying unobserved chances of recovery are in the two groups. My p-value for this turns out to be 2%, which is small. So my chances of seeing this, the two are exactly the same, is only 2%. So I've got enough evidence here to be able to say, well, maybe the two aren't the same. Maybe my paracetamol group is doing better than my placebo group. If we still have our 60% recovery in our placebo, but now we have 75% recovery in our paracetamol group, and we go back to our 100 people in each group, well, now we're back to our small sample size, but because we've got a bigger treatment effect and those two are further away from each other, chances are that there probably is a difference between the two and they're not the same. And my p-value for this is, again, 2%. And so, again, I would have enough evidence here to be able to say that there is a difference between the two. Now, you probably get used to seeing, you know, hypothesis tests and sample sizes all the time. So in the UK, we have a big issue with the adverts that we show. So whenever we have these adverts, you know, it will say, this shampoo makes your hair amazing, this many women agreed with it, and it's always some ridiculous number. And so I wanted to show you an advert, and I wanted to show you just how ridiculous these numbers can be. So I'm going to play you an advert.
Pearl Drops cleans. Pearl Drops whitens. Pearl Drops protects. Pearl Drops shines. Pearl Drops 4D whitening system not only whitens, but cleans, shines, and protects too. Ultimate whitening, up to 4 shades whiter in just 3 weeks. Pearl Drops tooth polish, go beyond whitening.
Okay, so that's pretty typical for some of the adverts that we have in the UK. And I wanted to just highlight this that was at the bottom. So this 52% of 52 people agreed. With what? Who knows? I mean, that's a whole other question. No idea what it is that they're actually agreeing with. Let's just say that they agreed that it made your teeth white. For argument's sake, let's just say that that's what they're agreeing with. But this 52% of 52 people that I actually want to look at in a little bit more detail. So we can actually run a hypothesis test on this data. But we have to think, in this sort of situation, what would be our null hypothesis? So you got to think that our null hypothesis would be the situation where people were just randomly agreeing or disagreeing with some statement. Because if everybody said no to some statement, that would actually be informative, And if everyone said yes to it, that would actually be informative. The non-informative case is if someone just randomly said yes or no. So the null hypothesis, where it was just pure randomness, would correspond to 50% of people agreeing. So when we're doing our hypothesis test here, what we're actually doing is we're comparing 52% with 50% with a sample size of 52. And if we work out a p-value for that, we can see the p-value is 77%. So really, that is not a statistically significant result. And yeah, in the UK, they're still allowed to present results that are not statistically significant. So one of my roles as one of the vice presidents of the Royal Statistical Society is to actually, we're taking on the Advertising Standards Authority to try and improve statistical standards in advertising. And we're going to be doing a parliamentary commission next year, and we're hoping to stop these ridiculous stats from actually appearing on our TV screens. There's another one, because it's not just statistical significance, though, that's the issue. So we've got another one where people agreed with something. After 28 days, 74% of 54 men agreed. Let's just say it made their skin nice. So again, we're comparing this with 50%. So our null is 50%, so we're comparing 50 to 74. And because they're further away from each other, even with our small sample size, you know, we get a pretty small p-value. So yeah, it's statistically significant. But how reliable is this number, this 74%? How much confidence do I have in that number? And we can actually put what's called a confidence interval on this. We can put a 95% confidence interval, which says if I was to repeat this 54 men 100 times, and I asked them all the same thing, what sort of values would I expect to get 95% of the time? And it turns out that our 74% is our best estimate, our best guess at what it might be. But theoretically, that value could take anything between 60 and 85. So, you know, 74%, how reliable is that? What is it actually telling me? How informative is this? Now, you know, we're used to in the UK seeing these surveys and knowing that they're rubbish. But uncertainty is something that we really need to think about. So the BBC just recently changed the way they present their weather forecasts. And I was curious as to what the weather's going to be like back in Oxford this weekend when I get home. So I took a look at the weather forecast. And this is the weather forecast for Saturday. And we can see that there's some pretty precise point estimates for our chance of rain here. So at 1 o'clock on Saturday, my chance of rain is 71%, which goes up to 78% at 2 o'clock and goes up to 83% at 3 o'clock. Now, those are very, very precise probabilities of rain. But I have no idea what the uncertainty is on that. You know, the uncertainty could be really small on that, or it could be massive on that. I'm not really sure how that is informing whether or not I should be taking my umbrella. I don't know how much confidence I can have in these numbers. And I don't think uncertainty necessarily needs to be really difficult to communicate, because we can do all sorts of wonderful things with graphics. We can have these bar charts with our confidence intervals presented on there, and that could just instantly tell us how much confidence we should have in the numbers that we're seeing. So graphics, they have this amazing ability to communicate really complicated statistics in nice, easy ways. But they also have the ability to do great evil. And I want to show you some of my favorite worst graphics. And the first one is from Fox. And here we have a pie chart from the 2012 presidential run, where we're looking at the presidential candidates. And you can see that this pie chart doesn't add up to 100%. What I think they actually did was asked people, would you back this candidate, yes or no, and then thought a pie chart was the best way to present it, rather than asking which of these three candidates would you prefer. That would have produced a proper pie chart. There's this one, looking at Americans who've tried marijuana. Again, they don't add up to 100. But if 51% of people have tried it today, then I don't get how less than that have tried it since 1997. I don't know what question they ask to get these numbers. I mean, they've put an uncertainty on there. We've got a plus or minus 4% randomly. I'm baffled by this. I have no idea what it's trying to tell me. We're not much better in the UK. So here is here's a plot from the Office of National Statistics, looking at our GDP growth. And if you look at the bottom, if you look at this axis, we can see that it's gone from 0.6% to 0.7%. So 0.1% difference. And yet those bars look really far away from each other. You know, you can tell whatever story you want by zooming in or zooming out of a plot and showing it on different scales. So that's something to always watch out for. And I think my favorite, though, is Ben and Jerry's, who somehow think that 61 is bigger than 62. This seems like a really bad example of where they had a story that they wanted to tell, and they were going to tell it. And I think that they were just hoping that you would just look at these bars and not actually pay attention to what the numbers are inside them. You know, they have an agenda, and they want to tell you a particular story, and they are definitely going to tell it. I want to go back to this what question we ask as well. You know, as I said in these adverts, it brings along the bottom however many people agreed, but we have no idea with what. Because the question you ask in statistics is actually really crucial to then the probabilities that come out. And I was asked to work out a weird and wonderful probability. I've got the radio clip from it, so I'm just going to play the radio clip, and then I'm going to talk about it.
A colleague of mine texted me on a Saturday morning to say that she'd just withdrawn from a cash machine in South London a banknote with my name on it. And she sent me a picture of it and said, "Is this yours?" And astonishingly, it was, and it was mine from some time ago.
So this was a Newsnight producer. He'd written his name on a £10 note in 2006. If you're ever in the UK, don't write your name on a £10 note. It's actually illegal, and I'm not sure how he then managed to spend it. But anyway, that's another story. 2006, he wrote his name on a £10 note. And then in 2016, a work colleague in London withdrew it from a cash machine. And they wanted to know what was the probability of that happening. So they called me up, and I was like, OK, let me have a think about this. So I want to take you through my thought processes when I tackled this problem. So first of all, I thought, OK, what's the chance that I withdraw a £10 note that I wrote my name on 10 years ago? And to do that, I went to the Bank of England stats, and I had a look at how many notes are in circulation and how many get taken out of circulation every year. So these are the stats from 2006 to 2016. And using those that are in circulation and those that are taken out, I can work. These are all millions, by the way. We don't have like 559 £10 notes. I can work out the probability that my £10 note would still be in circulation for each particular year. And then using this column here, I can say, well, what is the probability that my £10 note will even be in circulation 10 years later? And it turns out to be about 1 in 1,000. Given that it's still in circulation, I can then say, what's the probability of me withdrawing it from a cash machine? If I go to a cash machine now, what would be the chances of me withdrawing that £10 note? And there are 777 million notes still in circulation. So that means my probability that my £10 note is still in circulation and then I withdraw it from a cash machine is this 1 over 1,000 multiplied by 1 over 777 million, which is 1 in 777 billion. Now, that was the stat that they all wanted me to say on the news, because that was the most shocking statistic. I was like, no. That's not quite what you asked me. So it wasn't that guy that went to a cash machine and withdrew his £10 note. It was a friend. So what are the chances that one of your friends withdraws a £10 note that you'd written your name on 10 years ago? Well, to do that, we have to make some sort of assumptions as to how many friends people have. The easiest way I thought to do this was to look at average number of Facebook friends. And the average number of Facebook friends at that time was 200. So what is the probability that if you took your 200 friends, you lined them all up in front of a cash machine, and they withdrew a £10 note, the probability that one of them would be yours that you'd written your name on 10 years ago is this 200 multiplied by the 1 in 777 billion, which is 1 in 3.9 billion. But it happened at some point in 2016. You know, we don't just go to a cash point once a year and withdraw one £10 note and that's it, it's done. We take out a number of £10 notes over the course of a year. So we had a little chat, I had a little chat with some people, and we thought, okay, we need to make an assumption as to how many £10 notes people take out over the course of a year. And we settled on about two a week. And we said, okay, so we got about 100-ish opportunities for people to withdraw this £10 note in any particular year. So we multiply that then by our 1 in 3.9 billion, which turns into 1 in 39 million. And that was what I thought the stat should have been. You know, 1 in 39 million, the chance that this happens to this guy, that he wrote his name on a £10 note in 2006, and in 2016, a friend withdrew it from a cash point. Now, that might seem like a small probability, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's a rare event. If you think about the lotto, your chances of winning is 1 in 45,057,474. I did an interview, we changed it in the UK, we were the same, so I know the probability. It's a tiny probability. And yet you're not surprised when people win it because of how many people play it. So you'd be surprised if you won it because your probability of winning it is so small, but we're not surprised that someone somewhere wins it because of the sheer amount of people playing it. So just because this is 1 in 39 million, does that mean that it's a rare event? So I explored this a little bit further. And there's about 50 million adults in the UK. So what is then the probability that someone has a friend who withdraws their £10 note from 10 years ago? Now, I'm gonna talk you through how we calculate this. I'm going to do it in a number of steps. But the way that we actually go about doing this is to calculate the probability that nobody has a friend who withdraws a £10 note from 10 years ago, and we use a statistical property that says the probability of something happening is 1 minus the probability of it not happening. So my probability that I have a friend who withdraws a £10 note from 10 years ago is 1 in 39 million, meaning the probability that this doesn't happen is 1 minus 39 million. Probability that this doesn't happen to anybody in the UK is then this to the power 50 million. So then my probability that it happens to at least someone in the UK in a particular year is 1 minus that. So that's the calculation that I carry out to work out the probability that someone somewhere has a friend that withdraws the £10 note that they wrote their name on 10 years ago. What does that actually turn out to be? Well, it's 72%. It's quite high, really. It's about 3/4 of the time, you know, in a year, we have people withdrawing £10 notes that someone touched 10 years ago. It's about 1 in 1.38. We can't track this, though, because we can't all go around writing our names on £10 notes and then spending them. You know, just get out of control. But it really, it's not actually that shocking that somewhere this happens. But what we can see is that 4 slightly different questions gave us 4 very different probabilities. And you've just really got to think when you see these statistics, what exactly was it that they asked them to be able to get this? I want to move on to talk about airplanes and airlines. And I've got a couple of stories. The first one I want to talk about is the fact that 2017 was the safest year for air travel, as there were no passenger jet crashes anywhere in the world. No mortalities at all in 2017. Compare this to the fact that there were 39 selfie deaths last year. Okay, what's a selfie death? It's all the weird and wonderful things that people are doing in order to take the ultimate selfie. This has actually become so much of an issue that the Russian government has a safe selfie campaign, and they have leaflets telling you all the things that you shouldn't be doing whilst taking selfies. And some of them may seem obvious, like, you know, this guy here, but some people have tried to take a selfie with a gun to the head and accidentally shot the gun and killed themselves. You know, people are doing all these stupid things to take the ultimate selfies. So yeah, 39 selfie deaths last year, and yet none for air travel. So was 2017 actually the safest year for air travel? And, you know, we've had passenger jet crashes this year. So does that mean that that's it? Our heyday is over and it's just going to get worse from here on in? You know, is it all doom and gloom? So I want to do a little bit of an investigation that explores this a bit further. And I'm going to do a demonstration. And this is where, if there was a dice on your chair when you got in, you will need to take that out now. Could you please stick your hands up in the air if you have a dice, just so I can see where they are and how many we've got? Yep. Okay, brill. Okay, so these are speed cameras in the UK. And when speed cameras came in, the government had to decide where they were going to put them because they couldn't put them everywhere. They needed some sort of sensible strategy. So what they decided to do was to identify all the accident hotspots, see where all the accidents were happening, and put the speed cameras in there. Kind of seems like a sensible strategy. And we're going to recreate that now using your dice. So in a second, what I'm going to ask you to do is to roll it for me twice, although you haven't really got much room to roll it, so can I just suggest you give them a really good shake in your hand and just drop them on the floor. I'm going to ask you to do it twice, and I'm going to ask you to count up what score you get. That's it, straightforward. Okay, so give them a good roll for me twice. That was a four. It was a four. There you go. Okay, did anybody get 12? Did anybody get 11? Do we have any 11s? No, any 10s? Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna give you guys speed cameras. So we're gonna put speed cameras in where we've got the most number of accidents. So there's one for you, there's one for you. We had another 10 over here, yeah? No, was this 10 here? Yep, and we had another 10 over here. Okay, so we have identified our accident hotspots. Our speed cameras are in place. Now what we need to do is we need to figure out if they've actually worked. So what I want everybody to do is to just repeat that again. We're just going to do the exact same thing. So give your dice a good two rolls, even you with the speed cameras, everybody. Okay. Those with our speed cameras, what did you get this time? 8, 5, 2. And what did you get this time? 7. So what we can see is those places with the speed cameras have seen a reduction in the number of accidents, meaning that our speed cameras have worked, yeah? No, you're not convinced by that? Okay, no, obviously, you can put your hats down. Thank you very much. No, obviously, you didn't have a higher probability of rolling a high number that then changed when I gave you a yellow hat. You just randomly rolled something high the first time round, and statistically, the next time round, you would have expected to get something lower by something called regression to the mean. Now, regression to the mean says that we all perform according to some sort of average, but that we have these random fluctuations around it. We have these random highs and these random lows. And regression to the mean says that if something is a random high the first time round, we would expect it to be lower the next time round. Did anybody get a 12 the second time round or an 11? Yeah, what did you get the first time round?
5.
Five. So, you know, you could easily say those places where we haven't got the speed cameras, we've seen an increase in the number of accidents, and that only further justifies that speed cameras work. This was genuinely something that the government had to think about in the UK when they brought in speed cameras, because they did put them in the places that had all these high number of accidents. They saw a reduction, and then they said, oh, it must be the speed cameras working. And it took a bunch of statisticians to say, this could all be explained by regression to the mean. And what you need to be looking at is the long-term trends. The long-term average, is that changing? Is that decreasing? And that's actually what we're interested in. Now, we see regression to the mean an awful lot in sports. If you think about your favorite sports team, they'll sometimes go on random winning streaks, and they'll sometimes go on random losing streaks. And when they go on random losing streaks, sometimes their managers get fired. And then a new manager comes in, see an increase in form, and everyone says, oh, that's it was because of the new manager. But a lot of the time, that can be explained by regression to the mean. And a lot of, that new manager coming in isn't then, all of a sudden the teams are playing better. It's just a natural return to form, after this random law has finished. You guys have, you've got the Sports Illustrated curse, where if you appear on the cover of Sports Illustrated, you know, I think it's well known that you then go on to perform really badly. And here we have Matt Harvey at the front, who, after appearing on the cover of Sports Illustrated, went on to have his worst season of his career. You know, if you think about what it takes to appear on the cover of Sports Illustrated, though, it's a combination of your natural ability, but you're also probably riding one of these random highs. And when you appear on the cover of Sports Illustrated, you know, it's not a curse that's then seeing your form decrease. It's just naturally going back to what you would have been anyway. You're just naturally going back to your average ability. And it's not actually a curse. We come back to our aeroplanes. You know, we say that 2017 was the safest year ever because there were no air passenger jets. You know, that could just be regression to the mean. It just so happened that 2017 was one of these random lows. And because we've now seen some accidents, that doesn't mean that we need to start investigating things. It doesn't mean that everything's gone horribly wrong. It can sometimes all be explained just by regression to the mean. We had a spate of stabbings in the UK, in London. And our newspapers were saying that the London murder rate was now beating New York. As stabbing surged, and you know, all the newspapers were saying, was London now a lot more dangerous place to live than New York? And we have something called a reality check, the BBC reality check, and they did a full investigation into this. And they said, you know, the claim was that London had overtaken New York for murders for the first time in modern history, but the verdict was that a selective use of statistics from the start of 2018 appeared to bear it out. But the reality was that New York still seemed to be more violent than London. It's the danger of looking at these short-term trends and these random fluctuations and not taking into account, you know, these long-term trends. They're what you really, really need to think about. Okay, so I have one final story on airlines, and then I'm going to finish with a little game. But my final story on airlines, I have a little bit of a hobby, and that's taking on bad guys in British airlines. So we have an airline called Ryanair. They're kind of like your Spirit. Whereas your Spirit have yellow planes, ours have yellow interiors. And they play a little jingle when they land. And they're well known for being the ultra low cost, horrible, horrible airline. And I like to cause them bother. So last summer, they changed their seating allocation algorithm, and they said that if you booked your flights as a group, when you actually then checked in, they weren't going to sit you together anymore. They were going to randomly scatter you throughout the plane, and they were going to split you all up. The idea was that if you didn't want this to happen, you would have to pay for your seats. It was a way to make more money out of people. But all these people were saying that there seemed to be too many middle seats. Everybody seemed to be allocated middle seats, and it didn't seem like it was truly random. So we have a consumer rights program in the UK called BBC Watchdog. And I went on Watchdog, they did an investigation, and I ran some stats for them. So what they did was they sent four researchers on four flights. And on every single one of the flights, all four researchers were allocated a middle seat. And they said to me, okay, what's the probability of that happening if the seating allocation is truly random? And that's not really that hard to work out statistically. So they had all the information at the time of check-in, and they sent all that information through to me. So for example, one of the flights, when they checked in, had 23 window seats left, 15 middle, 27 aisle, 65 in total. So theoretically, those four people should have just been randomly scattered throughout these 65 seats. But they were all given middle seats. So what was the probability of that happening? Well, you got 15 middle seats, 65 in total. So the probability that the first person gets the middle seat is 15 over 65. Probability the next one gets the middle seat, there's then 14 to choose from 64 in total. And then we carry on and carry on. So 13 over 63, 12 over 62. And that works out to be about 0.2%, which is 1 in 500. So that's the probability of all four researchers getting middle seats on that flight, 1 in 500, if it was purely random, which isn't really that striking a probability. If you think about how many flights these airlines have every single day, you know, if your probability is 1 in 500, we should expect that to happen quite a lot. But it wasn't just this one flight that this happened on. It happened on the other three as well. So I carried out the same calculations for the other three flights. I then combined all of the four flights together, and I worked out the probability of all four researchers on all four flights all getting middle seats was 1 in 540 million. So a really tiny, tiny probability. You are more than 10 times more likely to win the lottery than you were for this scenario to happen. But as I said, small probabilities don't necessarily mean rare events. So, you know, how much of a rare event was this? So I looked at Ryanair's figures that they publish, and they say that they carry 130 million passengers every year, meaning that this probability was tiny for this scenario to happen. And so I said I was pretty confident that they probably weren't allocating seats randomly and there had to be something going on. Ryanair said, you know, I had my stats and they had theirs. I was like, my stats are right. But anyway, but it all kind of died down a little bit. And then there were these 12 women went on a bachelorette party. And they were all allocated middle seats on their Ryanair flight. And they got back and they got in touch with the newspaper and they said, oh, what are the chances of it happening? So I got the phone call and we reeled out all these stats again. And they asked Ryanair to comment. And Ryanair at this point actually admitted that they tried to keep window and aisle seats free when randomly allocating seats. So they admitted that they were keeping back the window and aisle seats, because those were the most desirable seats and the ones that people were more likely to pay for. So this random allocation was actually a random row from within middle seats. So it wasn't really a true random allocation. So I managed to get Ryanair to admit to their customers that they had lied, and I also managed to upset them in the process, because they said that they didn't believe that some of the negative media coverage, including a BBC Panorama investigation, was warranted. So we all feel sorry for them that I managed to get them to admit that they'd lied and upset them in the process. So I think that was a big win for me. I upset them again earlier this year. They released the results of a customer satisfaction survey. So they said that 92% of their customers were satisfied with their flight experience. Oh, really? Ryanair? So I decided to take a further look at this. And I had a look at the survey. So it was an opt-in survey. And I thought to myself, well, you're only going to opt into a survey if you're either extremely satisfied with the service you've received or you're dissatisfied with the service you receive. So then I actually went and looked at the survey. So here's this 92% that they've reported. If we look at the options that they give people when they're filling out this survey, they range from excellent to okay. So if you're dissatisfied with your Ryanair experience and you want to fill out this survey to express that dissatisfaction, you have no way of telling them that you are dissatisfied with your service. So basically, all they're doing is asking a group of people who are extremely satisfied with their service just how extremely satisfied they were with their service. And then they combined all of these three columns to make a 92%. It was absolutely rubbish. And so I was quoted in the Times saying that I thought that this was rubbish. And Ryanair had a really adult comeback. And they said that 95% of Ryanair customers haven't heard of the Royal Statistical Society, 97% don't care what they say, and 100% So it sounds like their people need to book a low-fare Ryanair holiday. So a very grown-up and adult response from them. But one of our members of the RSS pointed out that Ryanair carry 130 million passengers every year. And if 5% of them have heard of the Royal Statistical Society, that's 6.5 million Ryanair customers. And do you know what? We'd probably take that, to be honest. There you go. That's what I like to do in my spare time, annoy Ryanair. Okay, so I want to finish by playing a game with someone. And as I said, I've talked a bit about risks and calculated risks. I want to know if someone in here is ready to take a risk. So I'm going to... You don't even know what... Don't put a hat... That's like bullying!
I'm ready to take a risk.
I'm going to take a bet with someone in this room. And I'm going to give you advance warning. I'm going to put down real money on this bet. And I'm going to want the person who comes up to also put down real money on this bet. If you want to take my bet, you will need to put down a dollar. So that's prior warning. If you want to take part in this, you will need a dollar. Okay, so what is the bet? I bet that somewhere in this audience, there are at least two people who share a birthday. If you know this, then please keep your mouth shut. I bet somewhere in the audience, there are at least two people who share a birthday. This is just day and month of the year. And as I said, I'm going to put some money down on this. So I am prepared to bet $50 that there are two people in this room, at least two people in this room, who share a birthday. And I'm asking if anybody would like to take this bet and challenge me and say that actually everyone in this room's got a different birthday and put down a dollar. You want to do it? Yeah? Come on then. what's your name?
Valerie.
Valerie. Nice to meet you, Valerie. So, I have your dollar. I've got my $50. I'm going to put them over here in plain sight. There's the money. So I bet that there's two people in here that share a birthday. You say, no, you don't think so. Do you want to shake on it? So we're going to shake on it. There we go. So there's our bet. The way this is going to work is I'm going to point to people. I want you to tell me your day and month of birth. I will repeat it. If you hear your birthday, can you please stand up for me, wave, make a lot of noise so that I know that you're there and I don't lose $50. Okay. it would be a bad way to end my trip. Okay, so what's your birthday? Oh, actually, first of all, are there any twins in here? Because I'll be kind and I will exclude them. No, no twins. Okay, well, all right, sorry. June 6th. June the 6th. No. March the 15th. December the 31st. The cameraman stood up there and I got excited. December the 31st.
This was yesterday.
April the 4th. April the 4th. We got a match. Oh, no, I'm so sorry. I am going to take your money, though. But, yeah, no, I'm sorry about that. Let's give her a round of applause. Okay. I am sorry, but how fair was that bet? You know, what are the chances of this actually happening? We can actually plot this probability against the number of people. And this is what the plot looks like. So it goes up really quickly. And you only actually need 23 people before you've got a 50-50 chance of this happening. So if you're in a room full of 23 people, about half of the time, at least two of them will share a birthday. And it only takes, at 58 people, it reaches, you know, 99%. And there's more than 58 people in here. So, it was like a 99.999% chance that I was going to win that bet. It wasn't really a fair bet. I should have put more money down. So there we go. But this is something that actually surprises quite a lot of people. In the last World Cup, Football World Cup, actually, the squads were around 23 people. And quite nicely, about half of them had at least two people that shared a birthday. It was a really, really beautiful, nice demonstration of the birthday problem that was rather wonderful. I would just like to conclude and say, you know, whenever you see statistics in the press, think about the risks. You know, you see these relative risks. Think about the numbers that are associated with them. Think about the sample size and the uncertainty. Is this, you know, correlation or causation? And then I guess the take-home messages are eat bacon, don't eat cheese, you risk death by bedsheets, and never take a bet with a statistician unless you know the odds in advance. Thank you very much.
All right, we have time for a couple of questions. If you have a question, raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone to you.
Are the two pence complimentary or are we expected to return them?
Do you know what? You can keep the 2p. It's fine. It's the end of the trip. I don't need them anymore. But I do need the dice back, please.
How does working in this field affect your decision-making process in your personal life?
That's an interesting one. When I see newspaper headlines, I definitely do think about the absolute numbers. But do you know what? I did an interview recently about the lottery and about playing the lottery and things like that. And people... I do occasionally play the National Lottery, and people always say, you know, why? You know what the probability is. But I think sometimes, do you know what? Sometimes you have to think beyond the stats. And I think sometimes we all have our own personal relationship with risk, and I think that's also sometimes missed in the media. You know, I know that eating a bacon sandwich increases my risk of pancreatic cancer by 1 in every 400. For me, that's an acceptable risk. But for somebody else in this audience, that wouldn't necessarily be an acceptable risk. We all have our own personal relationships with them. You know, occasionally I like to play the National Lottery just because, you know, for that hour after I buy a ticket, I get to think about what I'd spend the money on. You know, it's entertainment value. And I think that sometimes when we think about statistics and we see all these things in the newspapers, we forget that we have our own personal relationships with them. The current president of the RSS, David Spiegelhalter, he calculated that every bacon sandwich takes 30 minutes off your life. And personally, for a good bacon sandwich, I'd give 30 minutes of my life, you know.
All right, I'm a numerically oriented amateur. This is not really a numerically oriented question, but it is about risks of everyday life. I invited my wife here, who worries about a lot of things. She didn't make it. This was about driving in the dark. She'll often say, you know, wherever we're driving, we should make sure to get there before it gets dark and then not come home while it's dark. And I disputed her whether it's riskier, and then I went online and I found the National Highway Traffic Safety and various other reputable organizations saying, yes, most traffic fatalities happen after dark. But I didn't see any reference in any of those stories to factoring out the alcohol factor, because obviously you're more likely to encounter people who are alcohol impaired in the dark, because probably many people more drink at night than in the daytime. I'm wondering how you would weigh in on that, and if you're aware of any statistics that do factor out the alcohol factor from driving in the dark risk.
So basically, you wanted me to say to your wife that you're okay to drive in the dark. this is exactly one of those correlation versus causation. This is where those confounding issues come in. I mean, it may be that driving in the dark is more dangerous even after those the alcohol effect is taken out, but you can carry out analyses that control for these confounding effects and then look for any sort of residual effect that's left over once you've accounted for all of these things. It's really interesting, though, when you talk about how these risks can inform your decisions. I was talking to someone before about riding a bike and whether or not you should wear a helmet. And we know that if we come off our bike, wearing a helmet is going to, you know, decrease our risk of death or injury. But that's conditional on us having an accident. If we wear a helmet, does that mean we actually sometimes cycle more dangerously and we take more risks? You know, there's all those sorts of things that you need to think about, that the difference between these conditional probabilities that then get used as sort of unconditional probabilities, because you know, the decisions that we make then affect the way that we behave. You know, if I choose to cycle without a helmet on, I might be a lot more careful. So it is really interesting, and it's not necessarily straightforward to try and tease out all of these little intricacies and subtleties.
Let's have another round of applause for our speaker.